two. We'll get started. Looks like we've got a couple folks missing, but that's fine. They'll filter in as needed. So we haven't met for a while, and so I will take an opportunity to catch everybody up, and then if I miss something, somebody else jump in and supplement my update. So the county commission did vote to adopt this committee's plan, which was to put out a request for information on soliciting entities who would be willing to privately build a courthouse and then lease it back. Oh, yeah. Oh, Pledge of Allegiance. Absolutely. Sorry. Yeah, thank you. Okay, take two, I'll start over. So the county commission adopted this committee's plan. We did a request for information. There was one response to that RFI, and that was Darcy Johnson, or some entity that he's formed, right, Bill? Okay. So Lincoln County Corporation is the entity that's being used, and they responded. So our county commission authorized state's attorney to enter into preliminary negotiations, try to figure out how we're going to get this thing done. So I guess that's the first update. The second update is, and you have the documents in front of you here. If you don't, I can hand them out, but they're on the greeting table there, is Sheriff Swenson came and briefed the county commission last week, Tuesday, and told us that in his considered judgment, he does not believe that the sheriff's department needs to locate his entire department out to the new courthouse. They did their internal analysis, and he believes that he can leave his staff here in this courthouse in the existing space that they utilize. And but there will still be some, of course, with a courthouse, there still is some law enforcement functions that have to take place out there. So originally, the square footage that was going to be used was, total gross square footage was 87,000 and change. Based upon Sheriff Swenson's analysis and decision to keep most of the footprint of his department here at this county courthouse, we're now down to 70,470. And so that results in obvious cost savings. And Andrew Etram prepared this. Andrew, thank you for talking to Sheriff Swenson. Thank you for doing the, and these are very preliminary numbers here, very preliminary numbers. But that results in a cost savings of somewhere around $6 million. So we've shaved $6 million off the potential project cost here due to Sheriff Swenson's decision to remain here at the courthouse. So we appreciate that. So that leads us to where we are today, which is to get an update on the negotiations for the courthouse lease. But before we go into that, Bill, is there anything else I forgot, or do you just want to supplement what I said with whatever your presentation is here?
I think you've covered it all.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions as to where things stand now that I can answer right now?
I have a follow-up, I may. Is Sheriff Swenson willing to stay here or go there, or is he only wanting to stay here?
I'd have the same question.
I think he's fine staying here. He said he would go wherever the commission wants him to go, but he has no issue with staying in this building.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I'm wondering about the 8 courtrooms. Are those 8 courtrooms that are
completed at the time the building opens, or is it 8 courtrooms for the future?
That's a good question, Judge. I think at our last meeting, I seem to recall that it was a 6x2 program. That was originally what this committee had reported out, if I'm not mistaken, where we were gonna finish 6, and there would be a shell of a courtroom or a multi-purpose room for 2 of those. But Bill, I see some head nodding there.
Yes, and that was, we started working off the 87,000 square foot number. I approached negotiations with them was first to go to the auditor, and we talked about what we could possibly do coming out of our budget. And we looked at that, the initial conversations, the numbers that we were being quoted, there was just no way we were gonna be able to cover that out of our current or future budget. And so when we approach this, we're not talking about a payment today. We're talking about a payment 3 to 4 years down the road. So something we can plan for and start building into our budget, or we can look for other revenue sources, because it's going to take some time for the building to be built. But what we are looking at is we're probably closer to 55,000 square feet is probably what our budget will afford us going into 2024 or 2025.
Now, Bill, is that net square footage or is that gross square footage?
I think we're working off of gross square footage.
So we would still need to trim down from 70,000 to 55,000.
And that is what we need to do before I can actually finish the negotiations. Is they have been very easy to work with. We have a general idea of how we want to proceed on this, which is we need to come up with a finalized plan before they can give us a number. Because without that in place, this is what we need. So when the sheriff's department said, we don't need to move out there, it changed what the planning was. It reduced the square footage. The number of courtrooms, if we build out 6 of them to begin with, and we don't build the shell, it reduces the size and the expense. We have a very preliminary, and this is just a general concept of what we were talking about, is, something along this line out at the property out there. It'd be 30 acres, and so both ends are available for future expansion. So if they wanted to build a sheriff's office or a jail out there, there'd be room. The courts could continue to go out the other side. If the commission never decides to build a jail or move the sheriff's office out there, there's still expansion for the courtrooms. But they were laying it out in a linear fashion so that we could just continue to go out with the building. And so that would be easy if it's 2 courtrooms. If it's 4 courtrooms, there would be enough room to keep going. So that was the idea. But where we're at is we really need to develop a final plan for them to look at and then give us a number.
So the idea would be to cut down on the number of courtrooms as opposed to taking something out, such as the state's attorney's office.
We could take the state's attorney's office out. We could stay over here, but then that means we would have to run back and forth between the courtrooms.
So the option is to have state's attorney's office here and you run back and forth, or not have the appropriate number of courtrooms.
And those are the type of things that we need to have a conversation about, because if that's what the decision is, then that's what we'll do. So there's nothing set in stone at the moment. We're looking for solutions and what we have to do in order to. I mean, I think it's very clear we're not going to build something that doesn't meet the court's requirements or what you wish to do. This was just an initial proposal that we kicked around for space. This would have 6 courtrooms. If that isn't going to be adequate, then we can look at removing other things from the courthouse.
So on the proposal that says $28 million, we should actually put 6 courtrooms and.
It should be six, and we're trying to get it down to about 22, between 18 and 22 million is where we're trying to shoot for.
Okay, and of that six courtrooms, instead of the eight that's proposed, four would be finished?
Six would be finished.
Okay. Thank you.
Bill, I just want to clarify what the judge was asking some questions about here. So on the price sheet that said 28 million, when it says updated program has eight courtrooms, did that mean six finished courtrooms plus two shells?
I think that
we didn't clarify between the two. So the way it's done right now, everything was multiplied by that $300 a square foot. So it would be eight finished in that number, and they'd have to be adjusted down for the two courtrooms being unfinished or two courtrooms being removed.
Okay.
I mean, there's plenty of options. We could remove the state attorney's office. We could remove the PDO's office and just leave strictly the court facilities. But those are all the things that I need direction on is what's going to be in the building and the final plans.
So should we receive a couple courses of action then? Course of action number one is what is the cost removing state's attorney's office. Course of action number two, what is doing six courtrooms instead of eight. Course of action, I'm just brainstorming here. Course of action number three is what is the cost of six finished plus two unfinished. And then of course we know what course of action number four or five is here. Eight finished, right, is 28 million.
I mean, if we, that's what I need to know is what's going to be in the building. Because then we can work on the price for it and the lease.
If I may, can I ask if there are other sources of funding or anything else? Part of my concern is if we put all of this money towards something and build it, we're going to have to go right back to the taxpayers because we have an inadequate facility, because the state's attorney's office has outgrown this facility, public defender needs more space, we end up having to do a jail, whatever it may be. We're going to be in a similar situation than we were when we moved into here in 2008 and think we have a lot of room, and 10 years will go by and we're all sitting at this table again saying, what do we do? So I think we also need to be very aware of why we're even here in the first place is because we need to be progressive and forward-looking. So with that, I would ask if there are other funding opportunities or anything else that you've looked into.
So I will go through the litany of things that has been looked at and talked about. I mean, these are just for discussion. There's nothing that our office is putting forward as the solution. We have talked about legislative solutions, which is going to the state and seeing if there's legislation to get some assistance. That one of the things that has been put out there was possibly seeing if the state could loan us the funds to do this, because they have a surplus and we might be a good investment for them. I know that there's a conversation about a half cent sales tax that's been discussed. There's always the bonding option for the courthouse. What we have been looking at is our budget and seeing if within our current budget and the future budget as the county grows, because the budget has increased over the years, using that money there to go ahead and afford or build a facility that we can afford. There is other financing. I've talked to other attorneys who do this, and there's possibly consortiums that are willing to build things or to front money, and those might be other possibilities besides just a straight up leasing possibility. Those are much more complicated, and it would take a lot more research to see if we could actually do that. So that's kind of the broad swath of the options that we have.
And there's a small slice of money that can be used from our COVID relief funds. It's a small slice for water, sewer, and broadband. So of course we're gonna need water, sewer, and broadband out there. So we'll be able to utilize some COVID money to do that. County has about $11 to $12 million in COVID funds. we're really limited in how we can use that, given the essential functions of what counties do. But we could certainly use that on our courthouse, or at least there's a seems to be a consensus belief that we can use some of that. So we could defer some of those costs using that. There's also been some discussions, and I've talked to Larry about this too, of, and this may be a little bit longer term solution, but can we find a way to create a COVID bank? We use our $12 million of COVID money and we hand it out to other entities that need it, and then in exchange for that, will they essentially buy it from us for, and I'm just, these are just as an example, 80 cents or 90 cents on the dollar. And I think Hunter Roberts and there's some folks up at the state who are looking into this idea. So that this, it's caught some traction amongst a number of circles to try to figure out, can counties monetize that COVID money so they can do build their courthouses and jails and do infrastructure building. So those are other sources of funds that we're looking into right now. And there's eyes at the state level. You know, those folks are putting some brain power into this to try to figure out if we can do that.
Well, that is, the constraints right now is just strictly what we can project out for our current budget is what we're working off of. But those are all out, the other options. So, and there's the infrastructure that Congress is looking at. There may be money there, but it may never get passed too. So. So that is where the negotiations are, is until we can finalize a plan, we can't really put a dollar sign onto it.
Do we need answers on some of these other possible funding mechanisms, though, before we start cutting the state's attorney's office or courtrooms or potentially adding a jail, which I think would be a money maker in the not so distant future? But those kinds of things, before we make those decisions, do we need to know how far we have to pare down, though? I know it's a chicken and egg sort of discussion.
So here's how I got to where I'm at, is that looking at our budget and projecting 3 years in the future to what the budget could go ahead and absorb, we could plan for it, and we could set aside, here's what our payment's going to be. So each year with an increase, we could set that aside. That's what I know we have for a funding source right now. If there was something else, well, then that changes what we can do. But if our budget is what it is and we have to live within the means, then we're going to have to figure out, we can do roughly, this is roughly the square footage that we came up with the math. And then the question is, what do you put in that square footage? And that was the answer. That's what I've come here and said, here's where we're at. If you tell me that there's going to be another $25 million out there someplace that we're going to use, well, then my answer is it's easy to negotiate. We can get this done tomorrow. The hard part is I think we have a certain amount of money and we have a certain amount of space. Then the question is, how do we use it?
Yeah, I think right now the bill for the solution that this committee came up with is about $1 million a year, and the county budget just cannot support it. You know, there's a $400,000 gap there.
How much do we pay per month approximately to house prisoners in Minnehaha County?
Just it's as about 170 to 200.
Thousand a month?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I know Sheriff Swenson said it, he expects it to be 200,000 here in the next 2 to 3 months. I think he reported that at the last commission meeting.
Anybody else with questions for Bill? Was there more of this presentation you wanted to show us?
No, it was just a general, I mean, this is just a general concept. It was just strictly space is what they're kind of
so we can start to work towards a number. No, we haven't got to the point of really having a developed plan at this point.
Okay. I don't have an agenda in front of me, do you?
I don't either.
Okay. It's our next agenda item. Well, I think we've knocked out both agenda items 2 and 3, and I think this is the hard part now, is we've got to do some brainstorming here, and we've got to do some discussion, and I'm really interested in hearing from all interested parties their thoughts, given on what they've heard. Don't everybody...
Can I ask a question of Sherry,
yeah,
please? Sherry, on my tax bill, there are two light items that I see. One is for the courthouse, and it's 0.070, and then it's for the county shop, and that number is 0.088. And those monies that we raise for that is the county commission just voted to do it and issue bonds and no one objected, and we built it? Is that how that went?
That's correct.
Okay. My second question is as growth has come into the county, and when we built this courthouse back in, was it 88, 89, 90? Can't remember.
This new site?
Yeah, this one. When was this?
This was 2006.
2006. When we built that, that new growth that's come in with new houses, new industries, et cetera, does that mean that point 070 that I pay on my taxes, it's going to be paid off sooner than I thought it was going to be because of all that new growth?
Well, what I'm doing right now, on the 28th, we're going to have a discussion about refinancing the bonds.
Mm-hmm.
I can cut what I've talked to Tom about, I can cut the payoff on the courthouse by 2 years. So that we got that in the works right now to get that done. The new growth, all that does is spread the levy thinner, so everybody gets a little bit. That's why if you'll look back at a couple of your tax years, you'll see that it keeps going down. It's because of the growth that your levy on that goes down.
So it used to be higher?
Yeah, yep.
Okay, so when we started the building, what was I paying, the courthouse building?
A lot, no, I'm just kidding. I thought we had something on that. I can look it up if you guys want to keep the discussion going. I'll see if I can find that spreadsheet, because I know that when we were talking about building the jail, Marlene had prepared a spreadsheet that showed where it started and where it was.
Where I'm going with that is if in 2 years it was in a position to be paid off, can we continue to that levy that was in effect?
No.
When we initially, no, could we do it by action, but without really making any difference on our taxes than what they would be today?
You could, yeah, because when I talked to Tom about doing the bonding, I think we looked at doing $30 million for a bond, and then it was going to be about, let me try to find that. It wouldn't be much of an increase, I could say that. I can find the number for sure, but... you ask me things I'm not ready.
Nope. You've answered my question. Thank you.
I think here at the county level, that which we have direct control over, we have, and I'm talking about sources of financing here, we have bonding. So let's kind of parse that out for a second. We wouldn't necessarily have to do the full bond out the full project, because we could pay cash out of our general operating funds, and we could bond for a portion of the courthouse. Say, for example, we pay $600,000 cash each year, and we do a bond for the other $400,000. I'm just thinking outside the box here. I don't even know if I'm using the right vernacular here.
I think you're right.
Okay. So that's, that would be option number one. So what are the pros and cons of bonding? Obviously, the pros are it pays for the project and it gets it done and it provides the services. The cons are it certainly results in a tax increase and it is subjected to public scrutiny. You know, the public gets a vote at the table here. Second source of funding we have is cash. You know, the county has $9 million in change on hand right now. We do have to apply $4 million in change to next year's budget, but we would have some cash available to draw upon. I think just based upon the way our budget is structured, we wouldn't just plop down the other $4.5 million. It could be used, though, as some sort of revenue stream. COVID monies, again, that's within our direct control. We can pay water, sewer, and broadband. So those are the three sources that we have direct control over. And I don't know, am I forgetting any? Is there anything else we have direct control over at the county level?
Question?
Yeah.
Are we going to get money to run the sheriff's department, which will be COVID money this year? None?
No.
Not that I've heard of.
And last year we did. And did that free up money within the county budget?
Yep. So I did find the bond email that I had from Tom, and he said for $15 million over 30 years, the additional levy would be 0.097 to start.
On top of the courthouse one, or would that?
Well, I would say by the time you're getting to the courthouse, what are we calling it?
Justice Center.
By the time you get to that, this one would be pretty close to being paid off, if not paid off. Because we're going to pay down a lot of it and refinance it.
Can you tell me what that originally started at when we built this?
I didn't find that.
The levy, please?
I can. I'm going to find that spreadsheet. I'm still looking for that. I'm finding everything you're asking for.
So thank you. There's potentially, in terms of impact to the taxpayer, theoretically, there is a scenario where your taxes wouldn't increase, but they would stay the same. And we would carry on the bond from this facility, and instead we would use that to finance the new facility. I don't know at what level. Right? So what I mean is, I don't mean that that bond would be extent. You know,
okay.
I know I'm worrying you, Sherry.
Okay. Well, I was just like, no.
So it would be a new bond, it'd be a different bond, but in terms of, taxpayers' contribution, they wouldn't have to cough up more money, but it would be the same. And I think we'd probably have to do some a little bit of financial analysis on that to figure that out. You know, how much would that, you know, for example, question number one is, if we wanted to keep it at the same rate people are paying now, that they pay for this facility, how much would we get per year for that? You know, does that make up our 400, or does that give us the whole million? I don't have an answer to that, but that would be, I think, an important question to have, because I think in terms of presenting that proposal to the commission and to the public, I could sense a lot of the public would like to know an answer to that question.
So to answer your question, Larry, when the courthouse bond started out, we in 2007, we had a levy of 0.28. And then it's in 19, it was 0.105. And you said now on your tax statement, you're showing, let's take a look. Congratulations. Okay, so currently on here, we've got a levy on yours. Oh, they're all together. That's not what I want to look at. And this will be on last year's because I don't have it figured out for this year's yet. So the courthouse was 0.088 on 20, pay 21.
Sherry, how much does that, how much revenue does that generate?
618,000.
When does that end? Is it 2027 if we refinance?
No, I think it would be 26. Let me see if I can. Let me go grab.
Doing that, can I just clarify with the deletion of the sheriff's department space between the two proposals, does that mean there won't be holding cells or anything of that nature?
The intention was to have holding cells in there and have the electronic monitoring and the 24/7 program still there and still space for that. Have holding cells, have a detention area between the courtrooms. That was the intention, is to have that basically the very limited jail staff or people who work with 24/7 electronic monitoring to be at the courthouse with a detention area and an ability to get at least two or three courtrooms that we can have in custody inmates get to them coming out of the detention area so that we only transport in the morning and then the evening. Otherwise, everybody comes down. If somebody's held during the day, they'll be held at the detention facility at the courthouse and they'll be transported at the end of the day.
So which line item is that included in? And I know we've got Andrew in the back, so I don't know if he wants to speak to these.
All of the security stuff that we programmed with the courts stayed in the program. So it's in that 38,000.
Okay. So that includes the holding cells and everything
yep.
security related and what Mr. Golden just spoke about.
Correct. When Sheriff Swenson and I talked today, that was definitive that all of that space and there was none of that really that could be cut. So all of that stayed in. The only thing that came out was the office space for the department.
Okay, so with the information that I have been working with Tom, with the pay down the refinance, it looks like we would have our last payment on December 1st, 2026.
That's with the refi?
Yes.
Okay. So, just thinking out loud here, theoretically speaking, we would have to cover, if we wanted to go with what I'll call the revised option, the $28 million option, we would need to find $400,000, just speaking in general terms now, in our county budget from the date we'd take over the building, which based upon our current projections is 2024, right?
If everything goes, yes, that's probably the soonest, but yes, that would be the general target area. Yes.
So there would be a 2-year period of time where the county would have to figure out where to get that $400 and some thousand dollars. And then once we reach 2020.
Seven.
So it'd be a 3-year period of time. Then you could go back to the taxpayers with a bonding proposal of and say, hey, we're not going to raise your taxes, but we are going to keep them the same. And it's to pay for the essential government function of a courthouse. Is that what you're thinking, Larry?
I was just asking. I looked at my
sure.
taxes today, and I just, you know, I didn't know this till I just asked. I
sure.
So I had no thoughts.
Sure.
But I like the idea.
Yeah, I think it's a possible solution. I think what I'm hearing from the judges is they're very concerned about their space needs, because they have a big docket and it's coming at them every day. And what I'm hearing is they need the 8 courtrooms. And what I'm hearing from the county is we've got 600 grand we can give you. Where do we find our other 400? And do we find that through a combination of bonding, cash, and COVID money? And then it's kind of frosting on top if we can get the state of South Dakota to agree to, you know, halfpenny sales tax and COVID banks and alternate financing mechanisms and some of that.
That, can I just ask you a question?
Absolutely.
On that COVID bank that you're talking about, that sounds like you're loaning them money.
So there's been significant discussion about this at the state level to try to figure out what do counties like Lincoln County do with all this money that we can't use, mm-hmm. and what is the permissible sidestep. You know, for example, can we give the money to another entity, City of T, City of Harrisburg, Lenox, Hudson, to do a project that would meet the requirements? And then in exchange for that, are we allowed to ask them to pay us back if we give them that money?
Yeah, because, and the only reason I ask you on that is because everything that I've read on the ARPA money is no loans, no loans, no loans. And I know that you're saying that they're looking at it at the state
right.
level. The only problem with us lending the money to the cities and in the projects they have to do, it would all have to be under the federal bid laws and we'd have to manage them. So that would be the, I mean, it's,
I think
if
you're
they
bringing,
let you do it,
yeah.
I understand, but I mean, that's going to create a lot of headache for us for managing their projects.
There's always a cost to taking money from the federal government, isn't there? It, granted, and these are just ideas that are floating around right now.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, that's why I think it's 4th, 5th, and 6th down the list in terms of financing mechanisms.
So my question becomes, and I'm just, where do we get the money? Right? And what are our options to get that money? One is we raise our taxes. Two is we potentially, you know, we bond it. Three is we cut things, and of the things that we've cut, we use it to either lease or to make the payment somehow, however we financed it. And then the fourth thing is the using of the reserves. And you had mentioned like $9 million. And Sherry, I asked you the other day, I said, what's this $100,000 interest from? And you said that's from $7 million. Is that the $9 million, the same thing, or is
mm-hmm.
that a separate?
Yep, it's all the same thing.
Same pot.
Yep.
And then the final thing is growth. And I'm sitting here, to be frank with you, it's not me that's causing this problem, it's growth that's causing this problem. And how do we make growth pay for the problem and not me? And I didn't cause it, but I'm also willing to pay my fair share. And what is our growth? What do we anticipate in new money every year? You said $400,000, is it more than that?
I'll look at, I presented the growth over the last few years. Let me pull that up. flip through these pretty quick, Larry. Okay, so the money that we've gotten for growth dollars, 22, we got 406, 21, and we got 394, 873. 20, we got 447, 163, and 19, 513, 540. So that's the money that we've gotten in taxes due to growth.
New money.
New money.
But what is growth? What's that mean?
So, for example, more residents move into Lincoln County and build houses, more businesses build buildings, the values of their land and their property increase vis-a-vis construction, new construction.
And do we think that's going to get a lot bigger in the short order, or is that probably about the number, half a million a year?
Well, it's historically from 2017, yeah, it's been half a million. Are we going to stay on that projection? How do you know? I mean, I would like to think yes, but at what, you know, we haven't seen any slowdown in growth in a while, so.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, and that doesn't account for, you know, you're going to have other competition amongst departments at the county level for that new money as well, of course.
How far behind is the evaluation of the homes? Because I look at ours, I live in Sioux Falls. Our house was, county come and checked it a couple years ago, and we kind of look at the houses for sale and see what they're paying for taxes, and I'm not happy I'm paying what I'm paying when I see what the neighbor's paying, because it hasn't been evaluated yet.
And I appreciate.
And if it's so overloaded to get the evaluations, I think you'd be ahead to hire people to get this done.
Right, and I appreciate that statement, but we have to keep in mind when you're looking at another parcel, you don't know if there's circumstances that their taxes are less. There might be some kind of exemption on their property. There might be, you know, they might be a disabled veteran. There's things on there that you don't see in the dollars that is a difference in your dollar to dollar difference. But according to Carla, the reappraisal is supposed to be done at the end of the year.
Yeah. And the county commissioners did hire additional appraisers previously, and they've been working on it for 6 or 7 years.
So we are in the final phase of doing the countywide, I guess I call it, revaluation process, Paul. There were several years, and I think I'm being charitable here when I say several, where property values were not keeping pace with the market according to their valuations. And about 5 years ago, before my time on the commission gave the new director of equalization, Carla Goosen, a mandate and told her to fix it, bring it all up to market level. And that process is almost done. So that is probably, you shouldn't really hold your breath if you think that the property valuation process is going to create a huge jump above that $400,000 number, because we're basically at the end of that process.
That $400,000 number I gave you is only growth. It's not due to reappraisal.
Right.
How often is a reevaluation done?
Well, the only reason I use the term revaluation is because there was the old director of equalization kind of let his foot off the gas, if you will, with regard to making sure that property tax valuations were up to speed with the market. And that's why he retired. New director came in and got everything current, if you will. So normally, there is never a revaluation process, because theoretically an appraiser's office will keep everything up to speed every year. If that, does that answer your question, Paul? You may not like that answer, but that's the answer I was given as well. Yeah.
Well, I understand there's discounts with some of that, but I'm looking at a couple of houses that I know there's no disability thing or any reason why there should be discounted. But that's fine.
Sure.
It's a question.
Sure. Understood.
I have another question, and I'm sorry for not asking it earlier, and perhaps it's obvious. When we were here last, we proposed, this committee proposed to the commission, you know, obviously Mr. Darcy Johnson had looked at not only giving or leasing or selling the land to the county, but also building the building and leasing that to the county. Is that something that has somehow gone away?
No, that's exactly what I've been trying to negotiate with him. But in order to get there, we have to have a final design. And that has to match up with what we could pay off our budget with what we came up with from the auditor's office when we sat down and penciled it out. We came up with a number. And then we went back and looked at what we'd come up with. Our budget wasn't going to cover what we were asking Darcy Johnson to build and lease to us. And so we have tried multiple different variations and different ways to try to get that to come as close as we possibly can with the money that we have on hand and what we expect. And so that's why when we got to the point of we just started talking about square feet, not necessarily what's in the building, out of the building. We did talk to, went and talked to the sheriff. I've talked to other people in the building. We talked about what we could take out from the county side. And that was the square footage we came down to that are in our current projections out of our current budget. That's the square footage that we'd be able to afford a payment for. And so that's how we came up with that. And so when we reached that point, that's a long ways off of what we had thought we were going to work on, which is that 87,000 square feet. And so since it was such a significant change in where we were at, that's why we're giving the update and coming back and saying, here's what our budget will afford. It isn't what we really want nor need. So
the proposal is still he would build the building and the county would lease it?
Yes. Okay. And we're trying to get there. And that's the question, which is I have limited resources from the county to try to get to that point. And then the question is how do we do that?
So what's the number that our budget tells us we can support?
We're working off of between 18 to 22 million.
Okay. Thank you.
Because that's 600,000 a year?
Yes.
So if we want to get the 28 million, we need another 400,000 approximately. And so if we wanted to, I don't want to say continue, Sherry's going to give me some side eye there, but if we wanted to continue on with property tax rates similar to what they are now, that's $618,000 a year if we wanted to extend that out to pay for a courthouse. Of course, it'd be a different bond.
Thank you.
So you could get your 600,000 there, and then you could pay 400,000 cash out of your general operating fund budget to make up the difference. And then we could shave a little bit off of the cost of the building through the COVID money. And then if there's other benefits out there from the state and things like that, we could further reduce it. But I'm thinking in my mind, and I'm not married to this, but I'm just throwing this out there, is, and I'm very interested in hearing from the rest of the committee, as well as maybe from the public in the future, is that a possible way forward? Bond for 600,000, pay cash out of the general operating fund for 400, and then use the COVID money. And I'm not trying to shut down any other discussion or debate. I'm just, this is kind of what I'm seeing as a possible solution, but clearly we're open to other ideas as well, clearly.
What type of cost savings, Andrew, would there be from if there's 8 courtrooms, the difference between what's a shell and what's finished? Is that just a minuscule amount?
Maybe you're 160 for the shell, 140 to fit out, something like that.
140 in addition?
Yeah, so 160 would be the shell, 140 would be the fit out, something in that range.
Does that provide like legitimate cost savings at the beginning? Probably not much.
Sizes of courtrooms, so there's some variations in the sizes. But if you just took the total square footage for the courtrooms and the associated spaces, so attorney-client meeting rooms,
so we had varying sizes. We had a small, a medium, and a large courtroom. But if you just took an average square footage per courtroom, it's about 3,300 square feet. By the time you do judge's chamber, attorney-client meeting rooms, etc. So if you took that times the two that you would shell out times it's $1 million or more. Potentially. And my math was 6,600 square feet plus the net to gross factor times 140. It's 1.2.
And what's the length of time? Let's just say the 28 million dollar structure. What's the length of time from time that the commission would decide this is project is go to occupying the space?
It would depend on how the project was to be delivered. If it was design, bid, build, then you've got the full design phase that would need to happen. 6+ months probably, and then construction starting after that. 6 to 8 months of design plus 24 months of construction, 20 or 24 months of construction.
So if the commission decided, say, by the end of this year, the structure would be occupied by January 2025-ish.
Yeah, fairly easily, I think. That could be expedited a little bit if it was delivered with construction manager delivery method, because design doesn't have to be 100% complete for construction to start. So you can squeeze a little bit, shave some months off.
Sure. So the 8 finished courtrooms fits in a longer term projection, not necessarily that 5-year projection. So that's an option, as long as the shell space is there, to have that readily available opportunity to grow and perhaps have a fewer number, maybe 5 courtrooms finished at the outset.
Correct. If you did 5, then I mean maybe you're $1.8 million less, you know, approximately.
So that would be
approximately 600,000 per
courtroom. Knowing that that going to quick math, occur in the future.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Joel.
Yes, ma'am.
I should have probably asked this earlier as well. but I'm not very politically correct, as you all know. So I'm wondering why the commission chair thought that this was the venue to come up with the financing options for building the Justice Center when I thought our work had been completed.
Yeah, I don't know. You'd have to ask her. But I think there was support from the commission to reconvene this meeting because we knew we'd have to pull together, you know, the multiple different opinions to try to find the solution, if you will.
But I don't think you can have a solution without the public being involved, especially if you're looking at a new bond and all the stuff that's been going on. So without having the commission actually do public hearings at night where people could actually come with the live streams and that kind of thing, this was a surprise to me. So I'll just be honest. I was surprised that we were expected to come up with financing options rather than the commission itself.
Yeah, I think ultimately the commission needs to take responsibility for adopting whatever solution it adopts. And I agree with you, we need to do public hearings. If it's one thing I've learned in the last 3 years, we've got to have the public, got to run these plans past the public. So I concur with you. I concur. I do think, though, that this committee serves a purpose in the sense of we have to flush some of these things out. We've got to make some proposals. My proposal may not be the best. You may have a better one. Dave may have one. I don't know. But, you know, I'm a big fan of creating multiple courses of action for decision makers to chew on. So I think this is a good venue from that point of view to try to flush out potential courses of action that we can follow.
May I ask a question? So we're talking about somewhere between $600,000 per year for a lease payment and $1 million per year for a lease payment. What's the term on that lease? How long is that lease?
We had tentatively what we're talking about is 3 10-year leases, and then at the end of the lease, we would have the ability to purchase. So it would be over at least 30 years. If there was financing to pay it off, then we could do that. If there wasn't, then we would continue the lease out to the end.
Because I think what we're kind of mixing up, and maybe I'm oversimplifying, is that we're making a payment of roughly $600,000 a year right now on the bond, which is an owned thing. And this would be a lease payment of somewhere between $600,000 and $1 million a year. Is that correct?
It would be a lease purchase. So is that what you're getting at, Dave?
Well, I'm trying to understand if it makes more sense to lease or to bond. Because in the end, I think it's probably better to bond for it financially. It's just convincing others to pay for that as a bond instead of a lease, correct?
I think potentially with a bond, you would end up paying less interest.
Right.
Is what I would think.
Because bond rates or interest rates are super low right now.
Right.
You know, Dave, I think you're probably right. But the public gets a vote at this as well if you go the bonding route. And you do run the risk that if you have an election, voters could say no. At the same time, we're in a republic. We elect our representatives, and we charge them with making some of these decisions, right? Some of those decisions can be overturned. Some can't. And you do run the risk of the public saying no if you take the straight bonding route. And you know, the state motto of South Dakota is under God, the people rule, right? But if you go another route, you have the possibility of creating a, I'll say, a negotiated solution that maybe the public may not fully like, but they're willing to stomach it because they know that we've got to have courts and, you know, we've got to take care of the administration of justice.
I appreciate your analysis. I do have an additional question, though. So if it's three 10-year leases, that's 30 years, roughly, at $1 million a year, that's $30 million versus somewhere between $18 and $22 million upfront cost. What's the balloon payment at the end to purchase it, then?
So these are all things that we've been working on. I don't have an answer for you because where we came to is we came up with a lot of different solutions and possibilities, but until there's a design and there's a number, we can't finish it off. And so that's where the negotiations has just kind of stopped, is because we realized at $34 million that wasn't going to work on our budget. And so then we started working on options from there, and we started going through square footage. We tried several different ways to try to come at this problem, but in the end it just came down to is we really need, either if we're going to do it at lease and under our budget or under our current budgeting system and pay it out of that, then we need to know. We kind of came down with this is probably the square footage that we can afford under a lease and come out with some type of fashion somewhere within that 30 years, and we can hammer that out. But I didn't know if that was going to meet the requirements for actually what I started from, because we started at 87,000 square feet, and to go down to 55,000 square feet is a huge change. So that's where it came to a stop, or that's where we're stopped at.
So you're saying that you didn't get to a point, you understood that you could try to negotiate three 10-year leases, but there was no discussion about what the balloon payment would be at the end to purchase. Not yet.
No, because we don't have a hard enough, we don't have a plan in place. The plan we started with is not one that we can afford. And so therefore, once we realized that, it kind of ground to a halt, because we really couldn't put numbers to a building that we don't have everybody buying into yet, or I don't have enough direction to finish the negotiations.
But would it be fair to say, just for round numbers, the balloon payment would be somewhere around $10 million? So then you're paying $30 million over 30 years plus an additional $10 million for a building that originally cost somewhere around $18 to $22 million.
That wasn't one of the ways that we were factoring or figuring it out over the time. So I don't have an answer for you.
Okay. Is that logic follow?
Yeah.
I'm following you.
Okay.
I thought we'd end up, if we paid all the dough, our balloon would be a buck, you know, after you made all your payments. But you had to ask the question.
Yeah. I don't know what's reasonable. Just trying to understand the gross magnitude of these dollars.
So when we left here some time back, we talked about what I'm going to call the, you know, the dream courthouse, and we went from, is it 80,000 square feet down to 50,000 square feet to make this affordable?
Went from,
where we're at?
We went from 87 to 70, and then 87 to 70.
How much to build the
34 million.
Thank you. And to build that, pick up the difference, how much more money do we have to raise annually?
That'd be roughly that, probably $400,000.
Is it another $1 million?
About $400,000, probably.
$400,000 a year.
For 35 million, that, no.
Let me
No, we get, Larry, we get $28 million for $1 million a year. $34 million was, I'm trying to remember what the approximate number was. Just if you went off 30 years at 3.5% interest rate. Sorry, Sherry.
That'd be $1,190,000 in interest on $34 million at a 3.5. But I'm not advocating for bonding, so right. Don't think right. That I am. But I have talked to Tom about the different options. And with the $35 million, would you get, because that's what you were first talking about, bonding over 25 years would add $25.60 per $100,000 of valuation. Over 30 years, it would add $22.70 per $100,000 of valuation. When you think about this, if you're making the lease payments, you're paying an interest rate. So you're going to put the money out there no matter what. So when you're saying bond or don't bond, if you're bonding it, you can control the cost more, I think, because it's going to be a lower interest rate. And when you're doing the lease payments, we don't know what the interest rate he's even going to set on there yet. That hasn't been negotiated. So, I mean, you kind of have to weigh that out. We're working a lot on what our flat number is, but we don't know what the interest is going to be on it. Mm-hmm. And that's got me terrified as far as budget goes, especially after the discussions we've had lately.
I think the consensus was the more palatable solution was to do the lease purchase agreement with as little bonding as possible.
Yep.
That is kind of the consensus that the commission and staff and others were starting to gel around. And again, I'm not saying that's right or wrong, just kind of giving you the lay of the land.
If I may, can I ask, if that's going to be more expensive to the taxpayers in the long run, why would we do that option?
Because
other than fear of an election.
Yeah, well, I don't think it's fear of an election. I think there's a very real reality. Taxpayers don't want to pay more money for these services.
Then I think we need to educate taxpayers better. That was one of the things I don't think happened even with the jail bonding. People didn't know. People still don't know the crisis, absolute crisis we have with our jail facility and operations right now. But I think that's something that this committee should talk about if we're going to go down that road at all. Because quite frankly, knowing more allows you to be able to sit here. I think you said it at one of the first meetings, Betty. You were just amazed and had no idea what was going on. And that's something that definitely needs to be done. I guess I would encourage people to do that. I do the extent I'm able.
And that's kind of, I'm on that same page, as we could potentially be paying more. We already have a burdened budget, and now we want to take another $600,000 out of it. So then what's going to start? What are we going to offset it if we come to, so say our growth stops and we don't have the new money coming in? How are we going to substantiate our budget? What services are we going to cut to make that payment that we're obligated to make? Because once we get into it, we're in it. And there's potentially no new money to pay for it. And that's my fear as the auditor. I understand everybody wants to do the lease purchase. I just don't know where the money's going to come from.
But I'm here as a representative, so.
Yep, as a taxpayer.
Anybody else? Well, I do think that we need to achieve some concrete action items tonight. And the concrete action item that the data input, if you will, that we need to provide our state's attorney and we need to provide our commission with is what kind of facility are we looking for? We've had ample discussion and we reported out a solution to the commission, which they supported, which was the $34 million option. Sheriff Swenson came forward and said he can, you know, assist with driving that number down to $28 million and still provide a secure facility. He just wouldn't put his staff out there, you know, all the detectives and the deputies and the command staff. But we'd still have all the other security features and holding cells and all of that. And I appreciate what the sheriff did. That brings us down to 28. We can maybe bring that down to 26 and change if we don't build out all courtrooms right away. You know, I think Andrew said there's $1 million in savings by not building out two of the courtrooms right away. So that's kind of, I guess I call that the 6x2 option. But we do create the shells. The space would be there for the courtrooms. We just don't finish them out. That brings us down to 26 and change. And then we have our COVID money for water, sewer, and broadband. And this is pure speculation. I'm getting ahead of my skis here. But that brings our price down below $26 million. So then we're in the neighborhood of, let's just say conservatively, 25 plus if we pursue that option. Is that a palatable solution or not? I'm throwing it out there. I mean, yes, I'm being a little intentionally provocative to get some discussion going, but is that a revised solution that this committee could drive some consensus around in terms of meeting our need and then giving that as a potential marching orders to Bill so he can go and negotiate that out with the Lincoln County Corporation? So I'm going to put that right there, Chad.
So my short answer to that question is yes. If Judge Hellman and Judge Rasmussen think that's not going to affect or lower the absolute minimum courtroom needs. Because that's, let's face it, that's why we're doing this. And to me, that's the bottom line that we cannot go below. So I guess I'll turn it back over there.
I think it's also as a taxpayer, not of Lincoln County, but a taxpayer in general, it's reasonable for us to look at what, if the building is going to be open for operation, let's say 2024, the courthouse space needs are X. We know that our growth is exponential. Let's just say it's 30% a year. And for the first couple of years of operations, that five number of courtrooms may be reasonable, but we need the ability to have another courtroom online within a short period of time, and then after a year or two, another courtroom, another office space for a new judicial officer be online without having to go through the time and expense of having to add to a building. So I do think it's reasonable to have a lesser number of finished courtrooms with the shell space that we can do that relatively quickly when that's needed. I think that's a reasonable compromise.
I guess my opinion is that that kind of answers the question on the direction, or am I jumping way ahead of the game? As far as if we're looking to make some type of recommendation to Bill as our negotiator or to the county commission, is that our recommendation? It's my question for the group.
And I'll also say that now the sheriff's department has said they are willing to not move there. I just received just a couple of minutes ago an updated spreadsheet from Andrew about the space needs. And I'm certainly willing to sit down if we need to again to look at that and say, this is the space that we can shell and this is a space that we need to develop for immediate mm-hmm. needs mm-hmm. And what is for future needs.
Anybody else have any comments after hearing the judges speak?
We didn't address where do we get the money to finish the inside, because this is just hard costs, right? So the furniture, the equipment, all that kind of stuff, where does that money come from?
Betty, a part of that is funds that come from the Unified Judicial System. It's a little bit hard to explain what is county obligation and what is state obligation. I think probably what I've heard is the easiest way to understand that is if you tip a courthouse upside down and shake it, what falls out is the state's responsibility, and what stays put is the county's. Mm. So it's wall in and out and inside the walls. So the furniture, the computers, podiums, chairs, those are state responsibilities. What's behind the walls, electrical outlets, the walls themselves, the light fixtures, those are the things that, generally speaking, are county responsibilities.
See, and that was new to me too. So, thank you.
Andrew, does Betty's question prompt any response on your part at all? Soft cost, hard cost? I mean, if not, that's fine, but
not necessarily. I mean, I think Judge Hellman's response that some of that gets covered by the city helps to understand that it's not all additional dollars in the county's account.
Okay.
And that software for the legal, because you don't have the stenographers or the court appointed.
That would all be UJS state expenses.
Okay.
Yep. The wiring to get that into the courtroom is county expense. Actually putting the video screens up, the cameras, the microphones, those are state expenses.
Well, I'm going to ask this question again. You know, we've got to report out something concrete tonight. Is there a consensus? And there doesn't have to be. I mean, you could tell me, Aaron's, heck no. That's fine. That's a legitimate answer. But is there a consensus that what you've heard from the comments is how we want to move forward? You know, I think what I've heard is we can bring this thing down to 26.5, and that'll meet the judiciary's needs and the county's needs. You know, are the committee members willing to give me an up or down on that? It's So this is where I put you on the spot. Make you give me an answer.
Looking for a one-on-one response from each of us?
No.
Or
I'm trying to get a decision reported out of this committee that I can bring back to the county commission and provide to the state's attorney.
Can you rephrase that question, please?
Yeah, of course. Would you support the $26.5 million proposal?
For me personally, I think it depends on how it's done. If it's a lease, that's one thing. If it's bonded, it's a different thing. And I really have a hard time understanding why we would spend $1 million on a lease annually, when the bond rates are so low. I don't understand that.
Are we able, and if we're not, that's fine, but are we able to separate the issue of financing versus what our needs are? Or are they hand in glove? Is it so inextricably intertwined that we cannot do that?
I need a bottom line of what I'm negotiating in order to get the building. If I have a square footage, if it's $26.5 million, then I can break it, we can work that into a square footage, and then we can figure out what goes inside the building. I can negotiate something and bring back a deal to the commission, and then it's a matter of, is it a good deal or a bad deal? Because I mean, if we're getting one courtroom for $26 million, it's a bad deal. If we're getting everything we need and it meets that and it meets it in the time frame that we can afford, well then we can make that happen. But I just needed something more definitive because I couldn't get to 34.
I think Dave brings up an important point. Go ahead, Larry.
Judge Hellman, I want to make sure I understand what you think you're getting, and I want that affirmed somehow. And I'm confused exactly what you're getting. I'm sorry. What do you think you're getting?
So what I think I would be getting if we just used the $28 million proposal, my perspective is that we would be getting a facility that's approximately 70,500 square feet. Of that 70,000 plus square feet space, a portion of it would be not completely built out. There would be shell space for, let's just say, approximately three courtrooms and the corresponding space. Let's say each of those courtrooms has separate judge chambers. Those judge chambers also wouldn't be built out. Maybe there's, for instance, a 5,000 square foot space with some additional offices for the clerk of courts. Maybe some of that space would be unfinished. The whole idea is that we need probably five courtrooms that are immediately ready to hold court proceedings along with the staff that's needed to assist and facilitate those proceedings when this building would be open in approximately 2025. We might very quickly need to bring online an additional courtroom or two within a year or two of that opening, maybe 3 years. I don't exactly know. But I think having the ability to quickly finish that space, I think it's responsible to have that space there and built and unfinished, so to speak, so that we could quickly do so if we have spikes in numbers like we have over the last 2 or 3 years.
And are you expecting this committee to say to you, yes, that's reasonable, that's what we're going to get you?
Well, I don't know if I'm expecting that committee. I'm just saying I think it's reasonable for us to say we don't need eight courtrooms finished when this building opens. We may, 10 years from the opening of this building, need to have had those eight courtrooms finished out and projecting an addition of however many additional courtrooms over the course of the next 5 or 10 years.
And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to have us all look at the same snapshot on our phone, and we're all seeing the same things, and not have us come back later, any of us, and say, this isn't what I was seeing. This isn't what I thought we were talking about. And that's, mm-hmm. I want to hear you say that you're happy, but I want this committee to understand what happy means to
right.
you. And that's why I'm trying to be as picky as I am. Mr. Golden, we're talking about a lease, and can we incorporate into the lease the concepts that the judge was just talking about, unfinished space, how we finish those other spaces?
That is what we have been discussing before. I think what's going to happen is we're going to have to get a design, sit down with the court, and make sure, before I go any further, that at least we have some type of drawing or something that has that all in place before I go forward any further. Because it's just not, there's no point in trying to hammer it all out unless we're concrete in what we're trying to build.
Thank you, Judge Hill.
Thank you.
Very much.
And could I ask a question? It's down here that jury selection would not be built out. Is that right? That's going to stay here? How does that work in a new, it says the multi-purpose jury selection, sheriff department training remain in their current location?
No, I think that just means the sheriff's department itself would remain in the current location, because each of them has that 25,000 or 2,500 square feet. And that was a space that in discussions we talked about being available for jury selection and or any sheriff's department training.
So then the
My
empty
reading
space,
is that's
so the empty space underneath there means remain in their current location, and the one above above.
Yep, okay. Just the sheriff's department is how I read that.
And then does that mean that there would be built out spaces for the attorney and the client as well?
I think those go in conjunction with the courtrooms.
Okay.
And the jury selection would just be, for instance, a room like this that we use in the Minnehaha County Courthouse. We call it our multi-purpose room. We use it for every kind of meeting that we have. We currently use it almost exclusively for jury selection. I think the sheriff's department also thought that they'd be able to utilize that space if they needed it for some type of training. So my reading of this is that space is included regardless.
Thank you.
In both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have a question?
I'd like to see a drawing of this courthouse that we're supposed to vote on. Is there a drawing?
I would guess the architect has that.
Pardon?
I would guess the architect has that, or Mr. Golden. I don't.
There was a very roughed out sketch that's a concept that isn't necessarily actually what it would be. It was just a general something to work from to get square footage and who was going to be in there. I can show it to you, but it isn't something that was real definitive. It's just something that Darcy Johnson's group was starting to work off of just so they could get an idea for numbers.
Well, let's put that up there again, Bill, and show Mr. Paulson and the rest of the group. And
so my disclaimer is going to be I've been hesitant to show it to anybody because I don't want anyone to get locked into something and think this is a drawing, because it's not. Because
right.
nobody
right.
said this is what it's going to be. So
all right, how do I set it for presentation mode? Anybody have any suggestions?
Go down to the bottom.
Okay.
Right there.
Right there. There we go. So if we start on this side, this would be the sally port. The area here.
separate hallway so that the inmates could come in and there could be some control so they wouldn't cross paths with the public or the court. The first courtroom was envisioned as an arraignment court, and there would be a detention cell to the side. There would be the first three courtrooms would be able to have inmates or people in custody. And they would be able to come in. There'd be a detention room where they could hold them and bring them in individually.
And just so people know, Bill, arraignment court is where people say guilty, not guilty. And it's where you get arrested the night before and they hold you over, and the next morning you come in and you may have done whatever it is you're accused of doing, but do you just kind of want to explain the importance of why we create a special courtroom for those people?
The idea is just so that the inmates aren't in public and they don't mix with other people. There's no contraband. There's no one assaults the inmate. The inmate doesn't assault anyone else. And then the others are just general courtrooms. And once again, pretty standard with the judges' chambers back behind here, and they had put in some extra rooms. This is just really just a placeholder for space. So it doesn't have to be this layout. It doesn't have to be this concept. This was just to try to get in all of the different spaces so that we could start to talk about what it's going to cost. So that's why I'm very cautious with this. I've been showing it to him because we're just using it for square footage.
Paul, does that help?
Well, you want us to prove money for, I don't know, I'd like to see something, I guess is where I'm at.
Yeah, I think if I understand correctly, what you'd like to see is, what does the $26.5 million option look like, right?
Correct.
Bill, what option is that up there? Is that the 34?
We were shooting for 18 to 22 million.
Based on that drawing?
Okay. Once again, we're just working square footage. All of that can move, all of it can change. All the stakeholders haven't looked at it and had their say on it. So, I mean, that's why I'm very hesitant to say, to put this out here, because I don't want people to get the idea this is the plan, because it's not.
Yeah, and I want to slice the bread a little thinner here. I want to make sure folks know on the committee here, you're not approving any money. I don't want you to think you are. I am looking for your valued input as to whether you think that the square footage option we're talking about is adequate to meet the county's needs. Now, I understand that necessarily presupposes that, yeah, there's a dollar amount tag to that. You can say to me, hey, I can go with that square footage amount, but, you know, that price tag kind of, I disagree with the price tag. I can fully understand that. I'm just trying to get a bead on whether I can get a consensus from this committee as to whether or not the square footage amount that we're talking about meets our needs. Because there is going to be considerable debate and hearings and all that in front of the county commission, which I invite you all to attend, of course, before we approve any kind of lease purchase agreement.
And would you do public meetings before that as well?
You have to. You have to do the public meetings. This cannot be one of those things where we put it on the agenda on Friday and it gets presented to the commission on Tuesday. That's just a non-starter. You know, this has to be fully vetted out over a number of weeks with the public. You know, we just need to get into that mode of operation. You know, when we make these big spending decisions, we do an open house, just like the state DOT does. Betty, you and me were at the very same meeting there in T a week or two ago, where the DOT presents multiple design concepts. They take public input. They go back to their bosses with the public input before making a decision. I see it laying out the same way in this process. We do an open house with design concepts. People know what the county commission is considering on approving. We hold multiple hearings on it, and then a vote or a decision is made. And at this point in time, I think we're just trying to figure out what guidance do we give our state's attorney to start negotiating with.
I'm comfortable with what we had discussed. Judge Hellman answered the big question that I had, and I'm comfortable with that, where we're at with that.
Well, I'm gonna call for a vote then and ask, will you support or endorse the design concept that I think Judge Howman explained to Larry?
Are you gonna have a vote on the financing as well? We're all gonna say we need to build it. The real issue is how you're gonna pay for it.
And I think procedurally we're not there yet, are we? I don't know how to answer it, Larry.
Fair enough.
I don't. I understand how if you say, let's do the $26 million option, you can be seen as endorsing that dollar amount. I get that. But I don't think you're necessarily deciding how to pay the $26 million. You know, because there's going to be a couple steps that have to happen in between there. Our folks need to meet with the architects. The architects need to do more work. They get together with Bill. Bill negotiates with Lincoln County Corporation as to what that's going to look like. That is actually a point in time where the actual dollar amount is going to get flushed out. What's the number of years? What is the interest rate? What is that? If you want to, after that happens, you could bring it back to this committee, or which creates, you know, the opportunity for the public to comment, or he just brings it back to the county commission and we hold hearings and there's opportunity for you all in the public to make considered input at that point in time.
Do you want a second on that motion?
Sure.
Second.
Okay.
Can we change that to that we don't have to put a dollar amount in it? We're just going by what Judge Hellman had said, so that Bill can go through and do the negotiations, and then we end up with a final number at the end, but not to do a motion that we agree with the 26.5. We just agree with what Judge Hellman has recommended, and then the sheriff coming out of it, so not putting the 26.5 million on it, because it could be more or less after Bill gets done.
It could be, and that's a valid point, and I concur with you.
Okay.
You know, really, all I'm asking you to do tonight is to endorse the way that Judge Howman briefed it out to Larry, okay? I'm not going to sit here and repeat all of it.
is that your motion, Bruce?
That's the motion.
Okay. Second.
Okay. Call the question. Those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. All right. So this committee can report out that there is consensus on what Judge Howman articulated to you, Larry. We can report that out to the county commission. We'll put that on the agenda for the 28th. And, you know, the commission will kind of do its left, right, up, down, and give the state's attorney's office some marching orders. Then I think the judges and other interested parties will meet with the architect to further flush out some of the changes that were discussed here. Then the architect will meet with Bill Golden, and then he'll meet and have some negotiations with Lincoln County Corporation. He'll come up with maybe one or multiple proposals at that point. Then what I'll do is, once we get to that point, I'll ask the county commission if they want to bring those back to this committee to further be flushed out, or if they want to bypass this committee and just discuss directly. But I will ensure that regardless, the commission understands that there is a lot of appetite for public input. You know, there is a desire to run all of these options past the public in multiple public forums.
I would take that even maybe a step further and say, if this committee supports that concept, that we formally go on the record as this committee saying, this is what we, yeah, I'll say the word, this is what we expect the county commissioners to proceed with, the public hearings and the public meetings, and let's vet this project, because we are still looking at an option of a bond. It's not off the table, we know that. And the only way that that, if it goes there, is to have public buy-in. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I need to do anything in the form of a motion or anything like that, but I feel strongly about that, and I'm sure I'm not alone.
Well, I would second that as a motion.
All right, so any discussion on that? All in favor, say aye.
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 Aye. All opposed, same sign. Okay, the ayes have it. So we will report that out to the county commission as well.
Thank you.
Okay, are there any other closing comments or opportunity for public comment at this time?
And again, that would be on the agenda on September 28th.
Can we do that, Sherry?
Yeah, I was just looking at the agenda, and we've got something on the 21st. Is that the same thing that we're talking about now? We've got on there.
We have the
update on lease negotiations, but are we still going to be able to do that on the 21st?
What day is our economic development bus tour? Is that on the 21st? I think the public in this committee probably expects the commission to have enough time. So I think we should go with the 28th instead of the 21st, because we're just gaveling in and out for the purposes of having a quorum and meeting the public hearing rules, or excuse me, not public hearing, but public meeting rules, because we may all be on the same bus when we do the tour. So
this item that we have on the 21st, update on lease negotiations for purposes of 2022 budget preparation, I can take off of the 21st. Can I move that to the 28th, and then it's the same concept, or is it going to be a whole different item on the 28th? Did you put this on here on the 21st, or did I didn't.
If nobody else wants to claim it, I will.
Okay. Do you want me to move it to the 28th, and we move can it add to it the 28th. All to one?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll move it to the 28th.
So we'll put it on there, and it'll be an action item for the commission to provide, you know, adopt or reject in part or in whole this committee's recommendation.
And Joel?
Yes.
I think what was mentioned is, if this is all done publicly, I don't know that, according to what Dave said, I don't know that a bond would be off the table when people realize what the cost savings is. So I'll just throw that out there, that it needs to be done publicly like we had talked about earlier, because that's a huge cost savings. Because tax money is tax money. I don't care where it comes from. It still comes from the taxpayer, whether we're paying a lease for that or we're saving over $1 million in that. But it has to be done publicly.
Yeah, this business of putting stuff on the agenda on Fridays and voting on Tuesdays has got to go. The public expects more. So, yeah, I agree. I concur. Is there anything else? Okay, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We will adjourn.